Well, good evening, Bethlehem Lutheran Church, and welcome to our midweek Lenten service. We continue along this theme of seeking aliveness. And again, having picked this theme months ago, really, this has turned out to be such an important theme for this time that we gather right now, because there are so many things that we take for granted. There are so many things that just drain us of life. And during this time, we're noticing more and more of those things that are just kind of sucking the life right out of us. And it doesn't feel good. And it can create anxiety and all kinds of other negative emotions that we have. And so it's important that we put that life back into us. And so that is the entire point of our Lenten theme of seeking aliveness. Because when we encounter the love, grace, and mercy of God, life flows back into us and then we are able to serve our neighbors with that same love and grace that we have experienced. We begin our service this evening in the name of the Father and of the Son and of the Holy Spirit. Amen. We sing our song.
This broken world, you walked it first. You know our pain, but you show hope can rise again up from the grave. Abide with me, abide with me. Don't let me fall.
Join our hearts in a word of prayer. Gracious God, Wherever we gather tonight, whenever we are joining this worship, we pray that you will be with us, that you will abide with us, that you will walk with us down the joys and the sorrows of life's path. Give us hope always that we might live out your call for us to follow in the way of grace, compassion, mercy, and love. In Christ's name we pray. Amen. We sing our next song. This season of Lent, we have been asking members of our congregation, members of our community, to come and share their stories of how they have found aliveness in this place, in the story of their own faith. And so tonight, we are thankful that Katie Christensen is able to come and share her story with us. Katie grew up in this church. She was baptized here. She was married here. She worked here. And she has a great story for us to share tonight. She recorded this at her home. Thank you, Katie, for the message that you bring to us tonight.
Good evening. My name is Katie Christensen, and I know some of you really well and have for many years, and some of you I've not had the opportunity to meet, and I'm sorry that won't happen tonight. But I look forward to a future when it will. And I'm really excited to get to be with you, even in this virtual way. I'm super honored to have been asked to share a little bit about my faith journey. And I guess that journey starts by telling you a little bit about who I am. I have an amazing husband of 21 years and two children, 17 and 15, Kelsey and Kylie. Some of you know them. We've been connected to Bethlehem. I have for a really long time. In fact, I was baptized there and went to Sunday school. I was confirmed, worshiped, rode lots of camels at the Christmas pageant, and was even married there and then baptized my own children. I also worked on staff through my 20s and 30s as the youth director. And that's how I've come to know many of you and have so many amazing, maybe my most favorite memories with many of you, and still hold you near and dear in my heart. And thank you for being a part of my journey. Currently, I am not working in the church, but the motivation and the work that I do isn't so different. I get to use a tool called Clifton Strengths to basically go anywhere and help people think about how they're wired. I would say wired by God. I can't say that everywhere I go, but it's my belief that we're wired for a purpose, that God has given us gifts to sort of unleash into a world that really, really needs them. And that's what I do now full-time with my business. And I get to go into schools, and I still work with families. I've actually done that with some Bethlehem families. So hi, if you're out there. And because it's just a wonderful communication tool, it helps us understand one another and those unique ways that God has created us to be in this world. And it helps us to honor one another when we can really recognize that and share that with one another. And so I get to work with businesses and nonprofits and just kind of anywhere where people want to know themselves better and work better. And so it's been really fun for me to venture sort of outside the walls of the church a little bit and get to still take that deep belief that truly, truly we are each created with a beautiful purpose the world needs to know. But that said, I did spend a lot of years in the church. And you know, I've shared my faith really all of those years. It was a part of my job description. And so when I was asked to share my faith for this, I was eager. I was happy to do that. I love the opportunities to share and to hear about others' journeys. Thank you to those of you who have done this already during Lent. But when I was asked, the world was in a really different place. The word corona was only a beer that I knew of. And life was sort of normal as life ever feels. And I agreed. And now as I have been preparing, I've been struggling because everything is so different. Everything is so new. Everything feels unpredictable. And if I'm honest, when I get in those places, like I'm in right now, like we're all in right now, fear can creep in. And fear for me can be this thing that sort of shuts me down a little bit. It kind of turns me inward on myself. I start thinking about protecting myself and surviving. I was at Costco like 3 weeks ago, kind of unaware of this whole thing that was looming. I mean, I'd heard a little bit, and I was there just doing my normal weekly shopping, and people were gathered around this rice pallet, and they were buying it, and they were anxious. And I'm telling you what, I got swept up in their anxiousness. Now, I don't even really eat rice, and I bought a big bag of rice that day, and I don't even know what I was thinking or wanting to do with it, but their fear was palpable, and it seeped into me, and I got caught up in it, and I became a part of this fear-driven thing that I felt was kind of starting to happen. Sharing my faith has always been about how I've encountered God, I guess. It's been about a journey of many encounters of God. My experience of learning about God, I suppose on some level, somewhere in me has helped till the soil a little bit, prepare me. I think learning about God for me has never been the goal. So when I was a youth director, my job description was to help young people encounter the living God. But I never felt like it was my job to give people faith, because I think that's the job of the Holy Spirit. And I'm pretty sure I'm not going to beat that one out. I don't really want that job. But I think it was my job to help people encounter, to till the soil, to become aware of where God is present and working all around us, because I think God always is. And yet I think there are things in our world that shut down our ability to see it and to receive it. And I think fear is the biggest receptor blocker that there is. Because it turns us inward, because it causes us to react and to go into the survival mode. I think that we are in a time where fear is at a whole new level. I think fear always is a part of our human experience, and balancing fear with something else, something that can pull us out of that fear, and instead of turning us inward, turn us outward, is always kind of the key, always kind of the hope. And for me, that's what my faith has been about, because it is in the times in my life where fear has started to turn me inward that I have had people come along and pull me and show me something different. I think about when I was in high school, and I lived and breathed for volleyball. Oh my gosh, it was my life. I don't really know at that time what I thought I was going to do with it beyond high school, because, you know, I was marginally good, but wasn't going to make a career out of it. But I lived for it. It was everything I thought about, everything I did, everything I developed and poured into, until I broke my ankle, right? My senior year, the first week of practice. And there went that. And this fear crept in, like, well, what am I if I'm not this, right? What am I if I'm not this athlete? What do I have to offer? How do I show up? Who do I connect to? Who am I? It was almost kind of an identity crisis, filled with fear. But at that time, I had people who kind of swept me up and pulled me into something else. And actually, it was the youth group at the church at the time. And my youth director happened to be my volleyball coach. And he sort of pulled me into this group of people who I was really resistant to, by the way. And but I got swept up in that. And we went to the mountains together. And I learned about God and community. I learned about caring for one another. And in a whole new way. I had wonderful parents, by the way, that had been telling this and teaching me this my whole life. But then, you know, you become a teenager and you need other people to show this to you as well. So they did that. And that was one that was, you know, as I look back in my life, that was this time where fear was taking over. And yet someone came in and turned my fear around and got me thinking about what it means to live in community and to care for one another and to love one another. And it changed something in me. It transformed something in me. From there, I ended up working at a camp, and that experience, I went into, again, not really knowing exactly what I was doing or looking for, but feeling a sense of belonging was important to me, and I felt that there. But there was a director there who just saw something in me that I did not see in myself. And that person, like, pulled me out of my tendencies to want to turn inward and help me think about how I might be a leader at this camp and how I might use those gifts that he saw in me that I didn't see in me to be about others. And I ended up doing that there. And that led me to wondering about what seminary might look like. And so I ended up on that journey and had people that encouraged that. I think about other hard times in my life where I've encountered fear, right? I think about when 9/11 hit. And some of you weren't around at 9/11, but 9/11 was a scary time. It was a time where we didn't know what was going to happen tomorrow. And it was a time where people were fearful. And yet I watched communities rise up and push back on the fear for something better, for something beautiful, for something that I saw God's presence working in and through people. As a young married person, I received a diagnosis of a health condition that was really serious and required a surgery and a long recovery. And I think of my spouse in that time of fear of death, fear of everything changing, who stayed with me by my side, by my bed, for 5 days, slept on the floor in a hospital so that I wouldn't be alone, to push back on the fear that alone I would have felt. And then I think about, oh my gosh, becoming a mom, biggest joy and the biggest challenge of my life. And oh, I think moms out there will identify with this. Like, I started to have this fear that maybe I had these kids that I wasn't capable of raising, that I wasn't enough, that I wasn't good enough or big enough. And fear started to turn me inward. And then I had this neighbor who wouldn't let me parent alone, who wouldn't let me turn in on my fear, who showed me love, who showed me a different way. And through her, my fear dissipated. And again, the presence of God was known in ways that were tangible. Again and again and again in my life, people have shown up in the midst of my fear, in the midst of me turning inward because I felt like scarcity was real and turning inward might just save myself. They pulled me outward. They helped me through their care, through their love, through their actions, to just shift my thinking so that I could be transformed in a sense into something that wasn't driven by fear. Lately, I've been thinking about a lot of different scripture and wondering what it has to say to our lives and to our existence right now. And one of the stories that has just really kind of been sitting with me is the feeding of the 5,000. And I think the reason I've been fascinated with this story is because it's about a group of people gathered in fear. People that are gathered looking for something, looking for hope, looking for food. And Jesus' presence does something to transform fear into something else. When Jesus heard what had happened, he withdrew by the boat privately to a solitary place. Hearing of this, the crowds followed him on foot from the towns. When Jesus landed and saw a large crowd, he had compassion on them and healed their sick. As evening approached, the disciples came to him and said, "This is a remote place, and it's already getting late. Send the crowds away so they can go to the villages and buy themselves some food." Jesus replied, "They do not need to go away. You give them something to eat." "We have here only 5 loaves of bread and 2 fish," they answered. "Bring them here to me," he said. And he directed the people to sit down on the grass. Taking the 5 loaves and the 2 fish and looking up to heaven, he gave thanks and broke the loaves. Then he gave them to the disciples, and the disciples gave them to the people. They all ate and were satisfied, and the disciples picked up 12 basketfuls of broken pieces that were left over. The number of those who ate was about 5,000 men, besides women and children. I think of that story and the miracle that happened that day. And I believe that, sure, Jesus is Jesus and certainly could have simply miraculously made more bread, right? And more fish. Jesus is Jesus. So that could very well be. But I also believe that maybe the bigger miracle that happened was that Jesus' presence pushed back on the fear that the disciples were feeling, the anxiety of the crowd pushing in and getting hungry, and how are we ever going to feed these people? And as that fear pushed back, the crowd began to let their fear push back. And as those first few loaves were shared in love, that transformed something. And everybody in that crowd maybe started reaching into their bag, right? And pulling out a loaf, a fish, and sharing it and offering it to others. And in the end, what this community realized is that when they each offered what they had, as meager as they felt it was, the abundance was great. The abundance was beyond what they could eat. It was bigger than what they needed. That is my experience of the love of Jesus that transforms me. When fear sets in and I come into the presence of somebody who calms that with their love, which I believe is a reflection of Christ, right? We are created in the image of God. That is the foundation of our scripture, that each of us are created in the image of God, which means that when we go to each other, we bring each other this reflection, this image of God's love, right? And it is that love that transforms my fear and turns me outward in love to other. Nothing else does that. Fear creates more fear. But love transforms fear into action, into ability to push out instead of in.
At this time, our service continues with our next song.
Restless heart, you lead us by still waters.
Everything that we have is indeed a gift that comes from God. And even in times where everything is changing, like now, we give thanks for those things that God has given us. And I would ask you tonight, if you have not yet asked yourself this question, what is the good that is now coming out of the situation in which you find yourself? Because there is always a silver lining to anything that we experience in life. I would ask that you reflect on that. We are thankful, as we always should be, for all that God gives us. And we give back for the sake of God's mission in this time and place. We give of our talents, of our passions. We give of our finances for the sake of our ministry. Even in this time where we can't meet face to face, we are adapting our ministries so that we can continue to reach out with God's mercy, compassion, and love to our congregation and to our community. You can give still of your finances in a variety of ways. In an online capacity, you'll see those as we continue our worship in offering.
Precious Lord, take my hand, lead me on, let me stand. I am tired, I am weak, I am worn. Through the storm, through the night, lead me on to the light. Take my hand, precious Lord.
Join our hearts in prayer. Gracious God, we give you thanks for this community of faith, that no matter where we are gathered this evening, no matter when we are coming here, we know that we are loved by you, and as such, reach out in love to our neighbors. We give you thanks for your creation, which you've called good. Help us to see those who are hurting right now, that we might reach out to them. Help us to see students who are at home who might need support. Help us to see families, parents, especially single parents, who might need love and support. Help us to see our medical workers who are stressed, who might need love and support. Gracious God, open our eyes to the world around us that we might share your grace and love in many different ways. We pray for all those people who are sick, either in body, mind, or spirit, those who are known only to you, whose names we now speak out loud in our homes, or we speak in the silence of our hearts. And gracious God, we pray for those who are known to our community. This evening, we pray for Margaret Beck, Salva Circa, Mary Emolte, Lillian Johannes, Jake Rodriguez, Bonnie Larson, Terry O'Hara, Jolene Perkins, Diane McDonald, Sue Johnson, Connie Kosserit, Sue Bach, Beatrice Griffin, Sonia Strutz, Marilyn Gordon, Jan Treckle, Deb Casper, Richard Tofty, Joyce Papoofs, Bonnie Cater, Todd Ferguson, Steve Nelson. Gracious God, grant these individuals named and unnamed healing, even if they cannot be cured. All this and whatever else you see that we need, we offer up in our prayer in the name of your Son, Jesus Christ, our Lord, who taught us to pray together. Our Father in heaven, hallowed be your name. Your kingdom come, your will be done, on earth as in heaven. Give us today our daily bread. Forgive us our sins, as we forgive those who sin against us. Save us from the time of trial, and deliver us from evil. For the kingdom, the power, and the glory are yours, now and forever. Amen. We sing our final song for this evening. This blessing this evening. Almighty God, Father, Son, and Holy Spirit, bless you now and forever. Amen. Abide in God's peace. Thanks be to God.